Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the first meeting of the 2019-2020 season of the local New York Arts chapter here up at CCNY. Our host tonight is Ryan Barna, who's going to give us a program entitled Dance and Grow Thin, Joseph C. Smith and the Evolution of Recorded Dance Music. From 1916 to 1920, Joseph C. Smith was America's best-selling band leader on records. Having led his orchestra at the Plaza, one of New York's most upscale hotels, Smith brought a much-needed warmth and intimacy to the 1910s dance music, only to be relegated during the Roaring Twenties to near-obscurity. He introduced key elements that bridged the gap between traditional dances and social dancing, establishing the foxtrot, incorporating vocal refrains and jazz-influenced elements, and highlighting individual musicians in his sessions, some of whom went on to become successful band leaders themselves. Ryan Barna will present his research for entitled Songs of the Night, Dance Recordings by Joseph C. Smith's Orchestra, 1916 to 1925, which he received a Grammy nomination in 2015 for. Using many visuals and recorded examples, he will explain the history of recorded dance music during the acoustic era, from the earliest days of the phonograph industry to Paul Whiteman and the dawn of the jazz age. Having been the first to publish previously unknown biographical details about Smith, Barna will also present on his life story from his earliest days as a freelance violinist to concluding his career as first violinist with Sigmund Romberg's orchestra in 1945. Now, let me tell you something about our presenter this evening. Ryan Barna specializes in early music, popular music, and acoustic recordings in America. He holds a Bachelor of Arts degree in English writing from the University of Colorado at Denver. He formerly served as a park guide with the National Park Service, including Rocky Mountain National Park and the home of Franklin D. Roosevelt. His liner notes for Archaeophone Records includes Arthur Fields' anthology, Singer, Songwriter, Soldier, and Songs of the Night, dance recordings of Joseph C. Smith's Orchestra, 1916 to 1925, which he was nominated in the Best Album Notes category for the 58th Annual Grammy Awards. This is Ryan's second appearance. He had opened up our previous season last year, discussing it was your grand old flag of George M. Cohan, and it was very, very well received, and I welcome him back. You have the floor.
Thank you, Seth, and hello, everyone. Before I get started today, I wanted to tell you a little bit of my personal experience in learning who Joseph C. Smith was, and how I eventually became interested in him, and a little bit about this journey I took when I first discovered him. So that's his band, as it looked in 1922. And when I first began collecting records for the first time, I would frequently come across records with his name on it, records such as this. They were very common. For Joe's day, he sold very, very well. His records are found all over the place, and anywhere you might find a stack of 78s, chances are there's probably one of these Victor Batwings of his lying in them. But the issue I had was, I thought he had a very sweet sound, and I thought his musicianship was absolutely wonderful. His records have a certain charm to them because they have such a strong violin lead, and I thought his combination of both his string section as well as some of his horns and his brass and reeds were also very well coordinated. But there was almost nothing that I could find on him. This was a little bit over 20 years ago. If I searched the internet, I couldn't find out when he was born. I couldn't find out when he died. And a few years later, once newspapers began getting digitized, I wanted to know more about him, and I searched and searched. Well, to make a long story short, I actually found his obituary. I found it in one of the digitized newspaper databases, and it was actually reported by the Associated Press. I found it fascinating, believe it or not. But anyway, he died in 1965, and from there, I went backwards. There are so many people out there named Joseph C. Smith. How was I going to single him out? Well, I know when he died, and I took that date, went through ancestry and other sources for like his Social Security records, found his birth, so I found out when he was born. I know now when he died. I even knew where he was living, who he was married to, so I worked backwards from there. And I did a website on him about 11 years ago, which I published for the first time, some well-known biographical facts, and one of them happened to include the mystery behind his middle name. I mean, what did the C stand for? And for many years, I even wonder, you know, who was this guy? To me, he was just a name on a record who made this beautiful music, but who was he? Was he even a real person? Well, he was definitely a real person, and I think in order to appreciate him more, we should also understand some of the achievements he made in such a short time. People have a tendency to dismiss Joseph C. Smith because his records were very mechanical and they don't have a whole lot of musician expression in it, or to put it briefly, improvisation, some jazz styles, but he introduced a lot of key things during his very brief recording period. For a Victor Company, this would have been between 1916 and 1922. He helped standardize the foxtrot. There were many dances that occurred before that, but he made the foxtrot more popular. He made the first bestsellers of certain dance songs that eventually became standards. That include Missouri Waltz, Rose Room, Hindustan, Alice Blue Gown, 3 o'clock in the morning. From as far as I can trace, he made the earliest known commercial recording of a Cole Porter song, the earliest known commercial recording of a George Gershwin song, at least the earliest ones I've been able to trace, the earliest known commercial recording of a foxtrot containing a vocal refrain, and that's a standard that eventually continued well into the swing era. He is also, from what I can tell, the earliest known bandleader to actually sing a brief chorus with his own orchestra, and that predates Ted Lewis's Columbia record of When My Baby Smiles at Me, but Joseph C. Smith did one just a little bit earlier. He also included key musicians who sat in during some of his recording sessions. Some of them would become band leaders and other prominent musicians like George Hamilton Green, Rudy Weedoff, Harry Ratterman, Teddy Brown, Harry Axt, Frankie Banner, just to name a few. The first to highlight a piano duet on dance records, something that Isham Jones, Art Hickman, and even Guy Lombardo would do in later years, but Smith pioneered the idea of highlighting a piano duet on a record. Also, the laughing trombone style, Harry Ratterman's laughing trombone, something that Ted Lewis would use for many years, but Smith was the first to introduce it. He was also the first to use a saxophone for his orchestra on a semi-regular basis, and one of the first independent American dance band leaders to gain international recognition. Beginning in 1920, his recordings began appearing overseas for the Gramophone Company, and those were exported not only to nearby England, but they were also sent out to France, Italy, Australia, and other parts of the world. So who was this guy? He was so important, but I knew very little about him. Well, from my research, he was born Joseph Cyrus Smith, August 13th, 1883, in Sag Harbor, Long Island. His father came from Russia in 1876. His name was Gustav Smith, otherwise known as George. He came from Grodno, Russia. His primary occupation was a tailor, and Joe's mother, Fanny Davis, was from Poland, and his parents got married August 6, 1882. When he was a child, I was told this by his great niece, who found my website and contacted me. When he was a child, he lost his right eye in a fireworks accident, And there's other documents that concur with this. If you look up his passport application as well as his World War I draft cards, notices that he has an artificial right eye. And as far as I can tell, according to census records, he only went as far as eighth grade. I wish I knew who instructed him on violin, because in listening to his records, he was a very, very skilled violinist. But like I said, when I began researching this, not only did I know little about the person, but in looking through past periodicals and advertisements, I couldn't find any interview or any kind of biographical source from the period in which he was a best-selling artist for Victor. And according to the 1900 census, he was already employed as a musician. A little bit more about him personally. He did marry twice. His first marriage was in 1901 to Henrietta Fried, and she was from Poland. And in 1908, they bought a home in Brooklyn. And the house that you see in the center there is as it looks today. Married his first wife in 1901 and purchased his home at 161 Martens Street in Brooklyn. And Joe continued to live there during the time he made all of his American recordings. This would have been from 1908 up to 1923 before he moved to Canada. So this person I knew little about, well, now I could even see the house that he once lived in. I mean, imagine him coming home after a recording session that day and the music I heard, well, that's where he went home every night. As well as when he played at the Plaza Hotel, which was a very high class, very prestigious hotel. He was the dance band leader there from 1914 to 1923. That's also where he would be living. So I think also in order to appreciate where or how Joseph Smith fits into this picture, we also have to know where dance bands and dance recordings come from on records. What we have here is a ledger entry from the first book of phonograph records. It was kept by the North American Phonograph Company. This entry dates from September 27th, 1889. It's an entry of Duffy and Ingram's band, and it contains the earliest known, this is the earliest known documentation that we have of commercially made dance recordings for the purpose to be put on sale to the public, at least the earliest that we could trace. And commonly, as far as what type of dances there were, commonly there were waltzes, polkas, quadrilles, lancers, the schottische, and also the two-step, mostly played by bands. These were all common folk dances, many that originated from England. And those were the type of dances that Americans back in the 1880s, 1890s, and onward would dance to. Here's another very early example of records being advertised for the purpose of dancing. Here's a page from the Edison Phonograph Monthly from 1904. It, of course, lists many lancers and quadrilles. And on the right there is an image of a Victor record that also came out in 1904 of what they put out as dance music. As you can see, it's a schottische selection as far as the type of dance is concerned. But as the decade went on, by 1910, dance music began to take a certain turn. In 1910, other dancers began to evolve, supposedly from San Francisco. And these would be known as inspirational dances. And what are these inspirational dances? They took all kinds of different names. For example, the grizzly bear, the bunny hug, the Texas Tommy, and the more popular one, the turkey trot. Well, these dances all began to catch on, and the record companies took note of it. And these were frowned upon, not only by critics, but people who happened to be in a higher class of society as being seductive and being very intimate dances. And they thought, you know, it was a rather degrading way of dancing and not particularly a type of dances that were safe for families. Well, that changed in 1913. Two dancers, husband and wife, team of Vernon and Irene Castle, appeared in the Broadway musical, The Sunshine Girl, and from that point, these new dances, these inspirational dances, as they were called, began to earn more respect. And the Castles received enough popularity that they lent their all-African-American dance band, who accompanied them, was led by James Reese Europe, to record for the Victor Talking Machine Company. This was in late 1913. James Reese Europe would become the very first independent non-studio dance band director. Before this, it was almost all studio bands directed in-house. But he was consulted and brought into the studio as a first independent director of them. And here's an excerpt of his first recording session. And so that's pretty much similar to how dance music typically sound. It was very heavy, the brass dominated, and in that case, the woodwinds and the clarinet section as well as the banjo mandolins also dominated. It had this very, very clunky sound. And I'll show you another visual. Victor went all out to advertise the Castles. Here's an example of a record sleeve in which the Castles are shown and basically saying that they endorse the Victor dance records. Well, in response, other companies followed, like Columbia. They got Joan Sawyer, another very well-known social dancer, to advertise their discs. And she had her band led by Dan Kildare, another African-American band leader, and they had him come in and make records for them. A couple other independent dance band directors followed. Frank McKee is one of them. And a couple other studio players, such as Vess Osman and Fred Van Epps, two banjoists, also brought in some of their own musicians and played on some of those early dance recordings. But they only lasted briefly, and Victor and Columbia turned to their in-house ensembles to carry out most of their dance recordings. But also in 1914, another change happened. Besides all these inspirational dances that I've been talking about, like the grizzly bear and the turkey trot being among the most popular, another type of dance became very, very popular. Thank you. and that was the foxtrot. It would take about a year or so for the foxtrot to really catch on and eventually replace the one step that was also very popular, but eventually the turkey trot, which was a very popular dance, faded out and the foxtrot was brought forward. And also, if you haven't noticed, James Reese Europe was also one of the co-authors of that song. And he and directed for the music for The Castles. Now, where does Joseph C. Smith fit in with all this? Well, during 1914, his band was offered to play at the Plaza Hotel. And similar to The Castles, he also accompanied two social dancers that were never became as popular as The Castles, but nonetheless, they had a very high reputation among the more wealthier patrons. On the left here is a postcard of the Plaza Hotel as it looked during the time that Joe Smith began playing there. It was completed in 1907. And on the right there, you see the two dancers that he would accompany. And this is a page from Variety magazine. It dates from 1916 and advertises Durant and Hawksworth when they appeared at the Palace Theater, a very, very prestigious vaudeville theater operated by B.F. Keith. And you probably can't see it from this slide, but in the review, it even mentions that while they were at the Palace, they were accompanied by Smith's music. Obviously, that would have had to have been Joseph C. Smith, who we know at that time was directing music at the Plaza Hotel. So without a doubt, this must have caught the attention of the brass at the Victor Talking Machine Company. So they were invited to make records in late 1916, and this is one of their very earliest this is their earliest recording they did there. And then their first release came out later that year at the end of November of 1916. And to the right there is a photograph of Joe, who is in the center there, and the rest of his orchestra. And you may notice the absence of a bass clarinetist, but you'll hear it a lot on many of his recordings. A bass clarinetist would eventually replace the string bass, probably for recording purposes, because it just gave a sharper bass tone than probably what an upright bass would have provided. But even at the beginning, they did very little to advertise who he was. They didn't even mention that he played at the Plaza Hotel, which actually would have been quite a feather in his cap if they had mentioned it. But like I said, Victor spent very, very little in advertising him. But his appearance would nevertheless be very important and quite transitioning too. I'm going to give you two examples here of the same title. One title was made by the Victor Military Band, Victor's in-house ensemble, and the other is Joseph C. Smith's orchestra performing the same title. And I will play them both for you, and you can hear the difference in how each one was interpreted. Thank you. Notice the strong violin lead on that last one. The last one I played was a newer version made just shortly after the Victor Military Band version. And you also notice a new innovation, too, is the way that Smith gets credit on there. Joseph C. Smith and his orchestra. Some earlier records, directed by James Reese Europe and Frank McKee, sometimes I'll say Europe Society Orchestra or Castle House Orchestra, Frank W. McKee directing. Well, this one just says Joseph C. Smith. It doesn't say like Plaza Hotel Orchestra. So even then, it seemed like he, by highlighting his name as being the leader of that orchestra, he was giving dance music something of an identity. And listen to the way that he had actually performed it. They were very carefully arranged, and with his violin as a lead, it actually gave some color, and he even provided some improvisation occasionally by soloing in some of his very early records. And that's something that the Victor Military Band and other studio groups didn't really do. They were very, very strictly focused on tempo. They didn't care much about veering off the page that much. They were very strict on tempo. But by Smith highlighting his violin and sometimes going solo, that added quite a little bit of difference in the way it sound. And it was quite pleasing to the ears. Because because many of those records, particularly Poor Butterfly, that was one of his first major sellers. But something else was creeping around the corner. Jazz. In 1917, the original Dixieland Jazz Band walked into the New York studios of the Victor Talking Machine Company for an audition. Well, what originally began as just a test, they end up putting into production. Livery Stable Blues supposedly became the very first jazz record, as it's kind of known in the music world. And it was released as a special record at the same time when Joseph C. Smith's version of Poor Butterfly just came out. From my observation, it doesn't seem like the original Dixieland Jazz Band had much of an effect in diminishing Joe's records. The original Dixieland Jazz Band recorded for a few other companies, but Victor held on to Joseph C. Smith and continued issuing more records of him than any of their other independent dance band records at the time. Now, his records can't be considered jazz, but he did include a couple elements where you can hint where some of the influence is there. I'll play you this example, and you can hear some of the carefully crafted influence of jazz, as well as a ragtime feel. You can hear the influence in it. Thank you. So you can hear that the ensemble is very close to the same size as the original Dixieland Jazz Band was. But you also hear them playing with a much more looser feel, including the slide trombone, which is, you know, not all out going wild, but it's still a little bit tamer and played a little bit with more skill, as you might hear on that recording. Also, commonly you would also hear the wood block. You hear the wood block on many of his records. He did have a drummer in his live ensembles, but he must have. They probably told him to take a step back and play some of the more smaller instruments as not to dominate the sound too much. So he was mostly confined to cymbal crashes, the wood block, and even the cowbells from time to time. But you can tell that it has a very loose, raggy feel, and he started introducing a little bit of that feel into some of his records. As I had mentioned earlier, he was also the first to introduce a vocal refrain to a foxtrot record. And the first vocalist on that record happens to go to Harry McDonough. He was Victor's New York studio manager and an assistant to Calvin G. Child. Calvin Child was a primary director of Victor's artist and repertoire. And Harry McDonough recorded with Victor since its beginning, back when Eldridge Johnson first opened up his own studio in 1900. So Harry McDonough's recording career actually goes back to the 1890s, but here he is in 1918 singing on the very first Foxtrot record with a vocal chorus. That, of course, started a trend. Harry McDonough sang in other records by Joseph C. Smith. He sang on Mary. He also sang on The Vamp with Billy Murray. He also sang on Peggy, which also happens to be one of McDonough's very last records that he made. And speaking of those singing on their records, as I had also mentioned earlier, Joe himself sang on made a couple vocal effects on some of his records. But in my opinion, I consider this one singing. Here's a picture of the label. And once in a while, he would be pictured in the Victor record supplements that would come out every month. About once a month, they put out their new list of releases, and sometimes it would have pictures of the artist in rather silly poses. Well, here's a couple where occasionally they pictured Smith, but still they did very little to describe who he was or where he came from. But on this record, Rainy Day Blues, I consider this one singing. He only sings three notes though, and he's a little bit pitchy on them as well, but I consider it singing. And right after this was recorded, came Ted Lewis's record of When My Baby Smiles at Me, he did for Columbia. But this in Ted Lewis was also one of the very first ones to sing or make a record with his own band, you know, singing along with them. But I consider this one probably the first one. And he did occasionally sing with his name credit on the label, and I'll explain that to you a little bit later. But we know based on oral evidence that this is him.
Rainy blue,
I don't know about you, but those are just enough notes that I can consider them singing along instead of maybe just yelling or making some kind of effect that way. And as I had also mentioned earlier, Harry Ratterman also sat in with one of his sessions. Harry Ratterman was a trombonist. He originally played with Earl Fuller's orchestra, but here he is singing on one of Joseph C. Smith's records, and he introduces a laughing trombone. And Smith made the first record of him actually featuring that as a highlight. And this was also one of his biggest sellers overall. It was definitely one of his top maybe two or even three best-selling records. It's still commonly found today. So here's a picture of him holding his trombone record label, and he was even featured on some later editions of the sheet music as well. Ratterman probably learned the laughing trombone technique from klezmer music. It was a similar style that was applied to the violin, but he, as an experiment, he applied it to a trombone. This record became a big hit, and it became a signature of Ratterman's style. He used it on directing his own orchestra on records, and he also featured it frequently when he was Ted Lewis's trombonist. You'll hear him doing the trombone, and the laughing that you hear in the background is also Joseph C. Smith doing laughing as well. And it also happens to be one of the only records, actually the only record of Smith documented in Brian Rust's jazz records. I read a description of him, I think it was in the sixth edition of Jazz and Ragtime Records. He calls it a nightmarish treatment, but nevertheless, it's the one record that's included in jazz records. The consumers went crazy over that record. As you could tell, it sold really, really well. And during the late teens, around the time this was made, this was about 1919, Joseph C. Smith was selling outstandingly. In the few cases where I had found supposed sales figures written on the back of some of record history cards, which are located at the Sony archives. We call them blue history cards, and cases where they actually wrote supposedly the sales amount down, and I compared it with Columbia's competing titles. It seemed like about 9 out of 10 cases, Smith just totally outsold the competition, if we assume those sales figures are correct. But nonetheless, he was, at that time, between 1918 all the way up to about mid-1920, he was probably the most prolific independent recording dance band leader that was on record. But that was all about to change very, very soon. In April of 1920, Paul Whiteman arrived by train to Atlantic City from San Francisco to play at the Ambassador Hotel during the summer. I have an article from the Talking Machine Journal that dates from 1924, noting that that record you heard there and that you see on in that picture whispering in just 3 years had sold 1.1 million copies. This was reported in 1924. And if it's any evidence, there is the history card at Sony that noted how many copies it sold. It also noted that somebody had written on there about 1.3 million, so that's pretty darn close. So now Mr. Smith has some competition. Well, how all this started was he was invited to come to Atlantic City from San Francisco to play at the Ambassador Hotel. During that summer, coincidentally, they were also holding the National Association of Talking Machine Men's convention there. Joseph C. Smith's orchestra performed for them. Now, Smith's orchestra did almost no touring at all. They played at a couple music industry insider events as well as some banquets and meetings for phonograph people. But other than that, it appears, at least according to my searches, that the Joseph C. Smith's band almost never left the New York metropolitan area. But while the National Association of Talking Machine Men were having their convention there, Calvin G. Child, who was the director of artists and repertoire for Victor, invited the band to come to Camden to make records. And their arrangement the key to their success lies in their arrangements. They are very uniquely arranged. Ferdy Groffé was the arranger. He incorporated something called a harmony chorus, kind of similar to how a barbershop quartet sounds, only he used sometimes two horns and two saxophones or two reeds and harmonized them together. As you can hear from that recording, the banjoist plays in a rather moderate fashion, but not too dominant, but just the perfect amount of rhythm. So that was Mike Pingator that you hear on the banjo. That was also key to his popularity. And somewhere along the line, in the middle of it, he also allows his musicians to improvise. Well, if you throw all this together, it spells best-selling records. It was definitely a change in how records sounded, including Smith's. So Smith had no choice but to update his own style. So instead of having his own violin do most of the leading, he lent some of the melody over to horns and saxophones. I'll give you two examples here. He was one of the first ones to make a hit with 3 o'clock in the morning, and that would also become a very standard dance number in many, many years later. But he was the first to make a hit of it. So here's how his new sound sounded with the mixture of horns as well as saxophones. So as you can see, he updated his sound just a little bit, but it still sounded rather conservative. It's the type of sound that you would still hear at some place like the Plaza Hotel, which was a very, wealthy class hotel. But if you listen to Paul Whiteman's version, not only does it have that certain amount of class in it, but it also has that danceable effect that he does so well, especially with his arranger, Ferdy Groffé, with his harmonization of all the instruments, as well as Mike Pingitori's rhythmic banjo. Listen to the difference. So even though Victor had already had a copy of this title in their catalog, they had already departed Smith. Paul Whiteman's records were selling, and they decided not to, if Joseph C. Smith even had an exclusive contract, he probably did, they decided not to renew it. And they decided to make a new version of it with Paul Whiteman's orchestra. And judging on the amount of copies I've seen of Whiteman's, it undoubtedly, without a doubt in my mind, had outsold Smith's original version, even though Smith was the first one to actually do it for the company. And one thing, and this is one of the mysteries of Joseph C. Smith that I was never able to understand, and that is why he kept to his original style instead of maybe adapting or even modernizing or even embracing perhaps some more jazz influences. I mean, if you look back at the brief period that he was making records, he was revolutionary in many ways, and now it seemed like he was falling back, sort of. But that's an answer that seems to have been lost to time. If only we could ask him. But if Victor wasn't willing to use him, at least a competing company still saw him as an asset, and that happens to be Brunswick. At the end of 1922, Joseph C. Smith signed an exclusive contract with Brunswick. He also kept pretty strict to the same style. He was another very early person to make a record of this song, which also become one of the great standards of music. Well, his time at Brunswick didn't last very long. He only issued maybe about 10 or 12 records or so. None of them sold very well, despite being the catalog for many years. So perhaps, and besides, he was also competing with other artists that were on Brunswick. I mean, there was Gus Hanschen's orchestra, who was directing the dance band records on that label as Carl Fenton. He was a bestseller on Brunswick, and also Isham Jones was also one of Brunswick's top sellers. And so here, Joseph C. Smith was kind of back in the shadows again. Well, maybe it was time for something new. So at the end of 1923, he decides to leave America and go to Canada. He had actually began performing in Montreal as early as June 1923. He would occasionally direct the orchestra there at the Mount Royal Hotel in their dinner and dancing room. It was called the La Salle Dorée. But maybe he found that Canada could be a fresh, fresh start. If his records weren't being so well received here in the U.S., maybe in Canada, it would give him a second chance. It would also give him a new start with a new wife, perhaps. This is Joseph C. Smith's second wife, and supposedly his mistress as well. Her name is Margaret Lynch. She was from Cork, Ireland. She worked as a dressmaker, and the two of them first met in 1915. This was, of course, according to passport information. And, of course, Joseph C. Smith, still being married, felt that their relationship was growing and that his original relationship with his first wife, Henrietta, was falling out. So this sounds like a rather juicy story that would be meant for the tabloids, but again, there's no newspaper reports about this stuff actually happening. So what happens next is Joseph decides to leave the U.S., and before he leaves, he turns the deed of his house over, where he was living at 161 Martens Street in Brooklyn. He signs the deed over to his wife, Henrietta. My only guess as to why he did that was maybe just as a settlement. I've looked in court indexes. I've never been able to find a divorce decree here in New York or in Canada about him divorcing from Henrietta. Not until many, many years later, though. So maybe he just did that for her, maybe as a settlement to maybe keep his name out of the papers. I mean, he was still performing at some of this very upscale hotels. So maybe in fear of a scandal breaking out, he just hands over the house. And he and his mistress, Margaret Lynch, move up to Canada. And while he was in Canada, he did a variety of different things, such as broadcasting on Montreal's station CKAC. He did this from January to April of 1924. And he also made 12 recordings for the Victor Company that was there. As you see, that's a postcard of the Mount Royal Hotel in Montreal. That's where he frequently played every night in one of his supplements descriptions. And what I'm going to play for you is one in which Smith is credited as a vocalist. And if you listen to him singing, you'll hear that it's the same voice as you hear on some of his early recordings that I mentioned out to you, like Rainy Day Blues, Laughing on Yellow Dog Blues, and he's heard on a couple other records. He's heard on Meow, he's heard on Taxi. But here he's singing an all-out vocal refrain. He updates his style a bit as far as his orchestra is concerned, but as you can still hear, it's still rather a low-key kind of arrangement compared to White Men and Ted Lewis and the rest of the better sellers during the 1920s. And these were recorded in Montreal and they were never issued in the U.S., so these records are actually quite rare too.
I like pie, I like cake, anything that they make, and I like crackers too, broken up in a stew. When I see jelly rolls, I lose all my control. But of all those things, I like you best of all.
So he stays in Montreal for about a year or so, and while he was there, he also made a new fan of his music. This would be the Prince of Wales, the future King Edward VIII, took a fond interest in Smith, and there's a couple news reports of him actually attending some of his performances. Then in October 1925, Smith was invited to London to play at the Café de Paris. He stays in London until early 1926, until he returns to Montreal, occasionally broadcasting on stations CFCF, and also went back to the United States in the late 1920s, occasionally broadcasting on WJZ. And that's kind of where he becomes into obscurity. He made no more dance band recordings, not with his own band, but he kind of falls back and starts performing at nightclubs, restaurants, as well as supper clubs. Here's a picture of him taken about 1930 or 31. This was just when he was beginning to perform at the Waldorf Astoria. That was in 1931, and there he is with an autographed picture of the Prince of Wales that was given to him. And during the 1930s, like I said, he played at many, many restaurants and clubs. He played at Sherry's, the Versailles restaurant, Café Montparnasse. Most commonly, he spent at least 5 years at the restaurant LaRue, and this was between 1937 and 1942. Also, Le Coq Rouge in the early 1940s. I don't really have much on him performing after 1942. I have him saying that he was in his fifth consecutive season at the restaurant LaRue, and this was about 1942, and I have almost nothing else performing of him performing except for one. In 1945, it seemed like he was invited by one of his old friends to come and play in new recordings with his orchestra. And that friend happened to be Sigmund Romberg. The musicians' union sheet that documented all the musicians that was on that recording on that day lists Joseph C. Smith along with his Social Security number on it. So that's how we are positive that he does indeed play on that. That also happens to be the only known recording session the only one I've been able to find with Sigmund Romberg's orchestra. He does play on, Romberg did conduct on other recording sessions with his orchestra later on that year in late 1945. He also broadcasted on NBC Evening with Romberg, in which he conducts a lot of his compositions and as well as other classical favorites on there. But I've only been able to confirm Joseph C. Smith on this one. If anybody has any idea how to trace musician union sheets, I would like to. When I checked the Sony archives, I was only able to find the complete listing for this one. But for some of Romberg's later sessions in late 1945, I haven't been able to find any sheets listing who the personnel was. But we do know now that he recorded as late as 1945. And some of they did six titles on this day. Four of them were issued, and some were also reissued on 45, Also, EPs, extend play 45s, and at least one LP, too. So, interestingly, Smith eventually made it into the vinyl era as well. But that appears to be, from what I've been able to tell, his last known recording session that I know of. He retired in June of 1946. He takes his mistress, Margaret, down to Florida. He was living in Forest Hills, Long Island at that time, and in May, when he was down there, he decides to divorce. He finally files for divorce in Florida. He divorces Henrietta in May 1946, citing extreme cruelty and desertion as grounds. Again, that seems to be a story that has been lost to time, but like I said, there's no period publications, you know, explaining the details about it. So he finally marries Margaret, August 13, 1946. And for the next couple of decades, that's pretty much the last I have for him. And then he finally passed away March 22, 1965 at St. Francis Hospital in Miami Beach. Cause was a heart attack. And that's a picture of his gravestone. It was taken by a Find a Grave volunteer who was down there. And his wife, Margaret, also died that same year. She died in November of 1965. And they, of course, are buried side by side. Henrietta continued to live at the Martens Street address in Brooklyn until she passed away in 1960. So who knows? That's something else I would also like to know some more details about. She just stays in the same home for decade after her husband leaves her. But so many things I'd like to know about Joseph C. Smith, but like I said, so much has been lost to time, and like I said, nobody, even back then, had seemed to have published any kind of interview of him, and Victor, like I said, did very little to promote his work. But I did the best that I could. This is the CD that I did back in 2015. It came out in 2015. It is, to date, the most comprehensive biography of Smith that I have put together. And there's a couple more nice details I've also included in the CD I haven't included in this discussion tonight, but it's still available. It's available from Archaeophone Records. And hopefully, hopefully with some of this more publicity, if we kind of get the word out there, maybe some more information will surface on Mr. Smith. I don't know, but I certainly hope that his appreciation grows. Anyway, I do appreciate everybody coming here today. Hope you learned something new and have a new appreciation for Joseph C. Smith, who for many years for me, I knew absolutely nothing about. And any questions, I'll be happy to take, but thank you everyone for coming. Oh, okay.
When he was selling a lot of records in the United States, did his records actually travel overseas? Did they sell overseas as well?
What they did was, well, I think what Victor seems to have done was they sent the masters out. And over in England, where the gramophone company was, they pressed records from those masters and they issued him on different series. Like in England, like they would have him on his master's voice, you know, and they would export him, you know, for England's purposes on the B and C HMV series. And then they had different series they would export to different parts of the globe, which is how they do so. And then in Canada, they also issued his records, American recordings, up there using the same catalog number, but different pressing plant, though. Yes.
Yeah, you noted that Paul Whiteman had a very high-profile arranger right from the start, and Freddie Groffet. Also, I believe Whispering took something like 10 or 15 takes before they got it exactly the way they wanted.
Mm-hmm.
So that didn't come accidentally. They were very finicky about it. Do you have any indication, any real evidence of who Smith's arranger was during those years?
I have no solid evidence. I can only guess that might have been Hugo Frey, who was, I read in a Variety report about Hugo Frey saying that he was Smith's technical director. Of course, this was many years after the fact. This was about 1925 or so that he was formerly Smith's technical director. But that's my only guess. And the ledgers, Victor recording ledgers, they don't state who the arrangers were.
What about number of takes?
Number of takes, it typically took Joseph C. Smith maybe only 3 to 4 takes. He did have to do a couple remakes, maybe up to 6, 7, or 8 takes, but maybe one unfortunate event, maybe 9 takes, but on average, it's only about 3 or 4.
So about average for the time. He wasn't as finicky as Whiteman seemed to be.
It didn't seem like it, no. It definitely didn't take him an average of 10 takes to do, you know, just one title.
Actually, I do have a question for you, Ryan.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know where the Lotus Club is?
I saw a picture of it on the internet, but I've never actually been there.
It's right across the street from Temple Emmanuel, 65th, and actually it's 64th, just west of Fifth Avenue.
It's quite the elaborate club, as far as I've
seen. It's up on the second floor. Essentially, it's a very big ballroom, if I'm correct.
Would you happen to know where RCA, you know, set up their studio in there?
It would have been in the ballroom. And they used it as late. Those Rombergs were done there. There was a period there. That's where I think Landowska did the Goldberg variations, the very famous set. And some of Fritz Kreisler's last recordings were done with Donald Voorhees and the Bell Telephone in there. So apparently he was rather quiet, hopefully. Mm-hmm. There was no subway near there. And it was well insulated because it was on the second floor.
Mm-hmm.
So
we know Don Voorhees very well in the Allentown area. After his New York career, he actually came to Allentown, founded, or probably co-founded the Allentown Symphony there.
Uh-huh. That would have been in the early 70s.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because the Bell Tel shut down in 72.
Mm-hmm.
That was the last of it. Actually, they had a joke about him. When they'd finished rehearsal, they used to say, one of the musicians used to say, "All right, Don, where are you drinking your dinner tonight?" So, it actually had quite a run with that. It started in 1940 as an experiment and ran until 1972. The only thing that was longer on the air, I think, was The Voice of Firestone that started, I think, in the 20s and went to about 63. So, Ryan, a pleasure. Thank you.
All right, thank you, sir.
Thank
Seth.
You again once thank again. You, come back. All righty, I just have quick announcement, and then I think we're... All right, next meeting... As what happened with this one, unfortunately, they are very booked in this room, and we had to do a last-minute change. That's why it was this Thursday as opposed to last Thursday. Next meeting will be on October 24th, and not at 7 o'clock. It's going to be at 8:15 because they have something going on here in the room. And it will be Matt Barton from the Library of Congress, and he'll survey recording venues that were used in Harlem over the years. So that should be very interesting. I think he may be bringing some people along as a panel, but we'll find out when we get there. All right, everyone. Well, hopefully we're going to have a mild, fall from what we've gotten today. So see you in a month. Okay, good night, all.